All right, guys, my name is Brendan, if you don't know me. I worked for the Walsh Group the last 2 summers. I'm going to quickly go over 2016, and then I'll spend more time going in depth in 2017. 2016, I worked on a project. First, my goals for 2016 were to learn as much as I can. So my goal is to ask at least 3 questions every day of my project manager, my assistant project manager, superintendent, whoever I can, really. And then since I was new to the industry, become more familiar with the company structure, like the values of the company, and how they go about doing their job. So I worked on the Beacon Hill Retirement Home in Lombard, Illinois. It's about a $12 million project. Expansion and renovation of an existing facility. They added on a restaurant, locker rooms, courtyard, theater, salon, all that kind of stuff. On the previous page, this picture, that whole building was all added, and then this courtyard here, this big circular concrete structure is a fountain. And then on the right side, you can see the edge of the building. The interior of that was all remodeled. And then I spent a lot of time doing basic intern things like submittals, transmittals, RFIs. One significant RFI was for that fountain. The surveyor's notes had the center of it in a different spot than the concrete formwork guys thought it should be in. So we decided to RFI about that. Figure all that out. Ended up delaying this by a couple of days, but nothing too significant. And then I also tracked the project schedule, updated it, and did weekly meeting minutes. And then safety walks. For safety walks, there was significant work going on with the overhead sprinklers. They returned off for a significant portion of the time. So I had to walk the site once an hour when they were turned off to make sure there were no fire hazards. I've been paying attention to what they were doing, if they were saw cutting things that produced sparks, all that. And then 2017, I went back to work for Walsh, and I was initially, I had a lot of hopes for the summer because I was asked to come back. I wanted to gain a lot more responsibility for day-to-day operations, like manage my list of contractors and suppliers. Again, ask more questions to learn as much as I can. And I'm interested in construction law, so I wanted to learn more about contracts and how that factors into things. I'll come back to the Grace Front. I was assigned to the Sheridan and Park Ridge project, which is another senior living facility. It was in pre-construction when I got there. They said that we'd be on site in 2 weeks. They didn't actually get on site until September. So I never saw this project. I don't have any pictures. I only have a map. I spent a lot of time in the office reviewing drawings. I was specifically put in charge of reviewing the stormwater pipes, elevations, and all that sort of thing. I actually found in the drawings one spot where they were pitched the wrong way, so we had to submit an RFI about that. No delay caused by that. Other RFIs were trees on the bottom, that sort of thing. Kind of boring stuff. The project kept getting delayed because of contract delays with the owner. There was an issue with the water retention vault underground, and I'm not super familiar with the specifics of it. Basically, the minimum price for a fix for it was $300,000, so the owner was not okay with that, so that was the major source of the delay. So I spent most of the downtime doing Walsh-sponsored employee trainings. I think by the end of the summer, I'd done 25 of them, so I did a lot. One of them was the LEED program. I actually went through all the classes for LEED, but I never took the test because they shifted me to a new project before I could schedule that. So I know all the LEED stuff, I just don't have the official certification. After a while, they sent me to help out on this project because they were falling behind schedule. They were remodeling a Target on the north side of Chicago, about 2 miles west of the field. I was mostly there to reorganize the inventory. Because they couldn't find anything. Target has a contract with Starbucks, and Starbucks has very specific items that they want in all their locations in Targets. So they couldn't find half of those things, which is really difficult. I managed to track most of them down, and then they asked me to stay on the project because they liked me and the other project wasn't going anywhere. So I was put in charge of contacting suppliers that were being difficult. There was one supplier in particular that was just never answered the phone. I would call them 6 times a day, never answered the phone. So eventually I had to go over their heads to like the owner of that company to actually get some of the materials on site. And then I did manage to actually complete one of my goals and helped review scope work for new contracts for subcontractors for this job. I was moved back to the main office to the Park Ridge project to do some more pre-construction stuff for that. And then after I was there for a little while, I was sent back out to the project because it had slowed down again. I was working on this project, which is a 33-story high-rise, Alto Roosevelt on 801 South Financial Place in Chicago. It's right near the park, the Shedd Aquarium, you can see there. I was only at this project for a week, so I only have one picture of it, it's on the next slide. But it was pretty interesting. I was mostly there for administrative things. They had me organizing the superintendent's data logs from every subcontractor, and I did that for the previous 6 months of work, which was tedious, to say the least. Then I was doing some work with payment applications, making sure that I was matched up with what subcontractors were reporting they had completed. This is a picture of that project. They had topped out before I got there. I think they were on the 27th floor with windows. And then for the last few weeks of the summer, I was moved to this project. CIM Group is a developer based out of Los Angeles. They had purchased the Chicago Tribune Tower last year, I think. And they plan to gut it and turn it into condos. The entire inside, turned into condos. The outside will stay the same. It's a historic Chicago city landmark, built in 1925. But the inside is going to be completely new. Some of the more expensive condos up on the 32nd floor are going to be like $10 million a piece. Very expensive. Right on Michigan Avenue right now. These are some of the original drawings from that building. I thought they looked pretty cool. Drawn in 1923. This is the view from my office at that project. I was sitting in the conference room, so I thought that was pretty cool. Yeah. Most of my work here was window quantity takeoffs, and then in the two floors of sub-basement, I was analyzing columns to determine how much demo was needed because they wanted to add steel bracing to every column. So that took me the last few weeks of the summer. And they actually asked for me to come back to this project next summer. So work, real work, gutting the building starts closer to June, this project. Going back to my greatest triumph, like I said before, I think my greatest triumph this summer was making connections and maintaining contact with all the people, getting along with all the people that I met during the summer. But I think every time I shipped a project, there was a new team. So that was difficult to deal with. But I think I developed some good interpersonal skills doing that. And then greatest challenges were also shifting projects all the time, having to be able to adapt to a new set of drawings, a new team, new dynamics every time. Different stages of construction, going from pre-construction to finishes at the Target store and all that kind of thing. Any questions?
So what has attracted you to construction law as maybe a focus or a trajectory for your professional career?
It's just, I've been kind of interested in going into law for a while, and I like construction, and I think, especially going over the contracts this summer, I think that's definitely something I would be good at, because I helped some of the engineers actually write out the activities, defining the scope of work, all sort of thing, proofread them for them. So I think that I enjoyed the experience, and I think that was something I'd like to do. Questions?
No. letting him off easy. Good job.
Suck up that water, mix in with all the wastewater that they usually take on, and clean it so that they're not having to do raw dumps into the river of just wastewater. So the purpose of this project was to double the capacity because with new state laws, we weren't able to do as many raw dumps as had been done before. So we went from 150 million gallons a day to 300 million gallons a day in capacity. And if you talk to Bob Bowen, he'll say that this is the best project his company has had in their history. It was a three-year project, finished a year early. It was under budget with no major injuries, and that's a lot to say considering there was like a really rough start to this project. Everything kind of went wrong at the beginning, but they were able to regroup and do a lot better towards the end. And by the end, we had so many change orders that they just ended up calling it Package B, and it was like a whole new bid. So my day-to-day tasks. So every day I was hanging out with all of the craftsmen. So this is like my favorite, this is Gary. And so I worked with the craftsmen, and if I didn't have anything to do, I'd just go hang out with them, see what they were doing, just kind of hear about how they were doing stuff and their plans and what they thought. So I was under a superintendent and a project engineer. And so we would do every week timesheets for the 15 guys, about 15 that we were over. They constantly sent me to hardware stores. Like I was all the time taking the truck to different parts of Indy, just going, they'd just be like, get in the truck and go, we'll see you in a couple hours. There was one time I left a hardware store for like the second time that day. I was like, okay, probably see you tomorrow. Then I walked back in like 10 minutes later and picked up something else. So I was in charge of inbound and outbound material tracking. So anytime I'd get something from the hardware store or if we had like major materials come in, tracking that to make sure we had it on site and knowing where it was. And then we were towards the end of the project. It was a three-year project and it ended like a month after I left. So we had a lot more going outbound. So anything with concrete formwork or any materials that needed to go back to the Bowen site, we had to track so that we knew the project was getting charged in the end. We had weekly owners meetings every Monday morning at 10 a.m. So the owners would be there, Bowen, Big Shots would be there. I went to 12 of them. I maybe stayed awake during one of them. They were not my thing. So then every day we had 4 week look ahead meetings at 1 p.m. So right after lunch, we'd have about 30 minutes to regroup with the guys. And then the management team would come in for 4 week look ahead and just make sure we were staying on schedule. And that was kind of part of being one of the most productive projects. So I was over handrail. So I'll show you a picture later, but we had like a lot of handrail on the site because it was like a big thing. The guys that they had running the grounds weren't the brightest. And so it was kind of just do not let them fall in the tanks. Like that would not be good. So we had handrail everywhere and I was in charge of that. And they also gave me the company truck, which that was a lot of trust. There was one time it was a laborer and I driving the company truck and I took like 5 left turns in a row with handrail in the back, like chicken to the other side of the site. And it wasn't tied down or anything. And I drive a little car, like I don't really slow down for turns. And so the handrail's just like starting to go like off the edge. And I see a right turn come up and I'm like, oh, I got this. And I just floor it and then just hit the brakes and whip the wheel. And we just see the handrail go, it straightens up and then it just keeps going, flies away. And so we just kind of looked at each other and laughed and we're like, we'll just carry it the rest of the way. So we got it all done though. But that was just kind of fun we had on site. I wasn't like that on the interstate. So when I got there, we were in Area 5, which was the clarifiers. And so there were four, like, they were basically just big million-gallon bowls for wastewater. And it was just slowly moving. They stunk. So they took the previous eight out of commission, and four were already done at the time when I got there, and we were working on four. So there was quite a bit of a learning curve. They got it down to being a week to make each bowl. And I have a video of how big it is. It's kind of show. And then I did see the final pour of the bottom, but that's kind of that. And then there was an issue with the equipment. It was like 3 months late. One of the subcontractors was just a rep trying to get it in. They ended up going out of service after our project because we ended up backcharging them a lot for everything they'd done. So when the clarifiers went online, it was probably the worst day of my nose's life. I mean, it was wastewater just sitting there, like a million gallons of it, already stunk, but like that video you can kind of see, it was just constantly flowing, and it was the worst thing ever. And then as soon as we filled up the first clarifier, one of the guys dropped a wrench, and that would have messed up the whole thing. So we had to shut it off, drain it all, send a guy down to get the wrench, and then start it back up. So the East ANS tanks, this is where the handrail is really important because these pretty much just bubble. And then as the air goes up, anything heavy just gets sucked to the bottom. So if one of the guys fell in there, like he was not coming out. And so we had to completely empty these and redesign them. And so that was kind of cool. They were just like huge tanks, and they're all attached like underwater. Like you can't really see it, but they were all attached, and then they floated into this river. So my takeaway, I just want to be able to kind of navigate a construction site, which I think after that, like I was constantly on site. So I definitely got to do that. By the end, the engineer that I was with, he was not the best. So the guys who I was with, they're like, yeah, if we have problems, we always just come to you because we know you'll help us. Like, he'll just forget. So organization is make or break. We were in the office one day, and our superintendent was like, yeah, do you guys know how much time is wasted by looking for materials that we've misplaced? I was like, well, my first 2 weeks here was a complete waste because that's all we did. Which they knew I was kidding, but at the same time, like, it was 100%. All we did was drive around looking for stuff that was lost. So I really wish I had known before that a stinky project doesn't mean a stinky company, because my next summer I switched companies, and that was a big regret. So my biggest triumph was being substitute project engineer. I left early one week, like Wednesday, and when I came back Monday, one of the project engineers was like, hey, Autumn, you're working on this for me. Can you give me those documents? And I was like, oh, I gave those to my PE. He was going to finish them while I was out. And he's like, oh, they didn't tell you they fired him? I was like, no, thanks. And this was like lunch. Like, nobody got to tell me. They're like, we thought you'd figure it out. So they had me step into his role and do a lot of his stuff for the last few weeks while they figured out who was going to take over. But he made a lot of mistakes, so it was probably a mess. So my last summer was with Walsh. I was at the Rush Oak Park Hospital in Chicago. And it was a $25 million ER expansion project. And so I got there. They had been on site less than a month, and it was a year and a half project. So right here, the orange, what we were doing while I was there was demoing a five-story dormitories where nuns and nurses used to stay. And we were building a new emergency room addition that was one story, but capable of three floors of vertical expansion once the hospital could afford it. So my day-to-day tasks, I did a lot of contacting subcontractors just on different things. We were supposed to have the 100% drawings like 2 weeks after I started, but there was just a whole bunch of delays with them, and we ended up getting them my last day on site. So we were trying to work off of the 75s and get bids and still get our subcontractors. And so it was like a lot of calling them, and they're like, well, we'll bid when you get the drawings. Like, we're not gonna bid now. Like, well, we can't get the drawings. So doing scope sheets, document tracking. So there was only two other management staff on site, and then our superintendent. We had two superintendents for a while, but they couldn't do it all, so they had me do like a lot of the like easier tracking. A lot of sidewalks, and then weekly owners meetings. Again, did not stay awake completely for those. So demolition. We had 4 months of demolition, so we had a month of asbestos and abatement. And during that time, we weren't allowed to go in the building. And so we did have a major recordable injury during that time, but because we had hired a third party to supervise that, because we weren't allowed to go and we weren't trained, the injury ended up coming back on the subcontractor and the third party people who oversaw it, and Walsh didn't get docked for it. And then there were 3 months of heavy demolition. That's kind of what that is. So that was pretty cool, just seeing them like go and crunch up the concrete. We had Bring Your Pet to Work Day. Ninja was the only pet that participated, but he had a good time. Okay, so my takeaway, I really just wanted to know if I wanted to do healthcare, because the wastewater, it kind of just really stumped, and I was always interested in healthcare. So that was my goal, to see if I was interested. Lesson learned that two people can't run a whole job, especially our superintendent. He started like a week before me, and I think right away they wanted to kick him off the site. So he caused a lot of problems the whole time, and we couldn't fire him, and he just kept causing problems, and we couldn't kick him off site. So that was a major, just kind of seeing like different people and seeing like the disrespect and like the fact that we weren't allowed to get rid of him, and he just kept doing what he wanted. Things I wish I knew, I could travel to other sites to get help. So like I said, we were doing a lot of scope sheets, and I had never done that, and there were only two people on my site, and they didn't have time for me. So I think I worked on scope sheets for like a month, and then I had to turn them in, and my boss texted me that day after work, and she's like, hey, so on Monday you're gonna report to this site, and they're gonna help you learn how to do this. They're expecting you. I was like, okay, thanks. Like, she realized then that I had no idea what I was doing. So they taught me how to do those, kind of. And my biggest triumph was just completing stuff without any guidance at all. It was just kind of like, here you go, and get back to me when you can. And so that was just the biggest triumph. Are there any questions?
What was your tracking, material tracking system that you used above? Just in your head and a spreadsheet, or?
No, we had a spreadsheet that we'd fill out, and then we would keep a copy on site, and two copies would go from the truck driver. So I think one went to the main phone office, and one went to the equipment laid out.
So it wasn't like a scanning or anything?
No, it was just all just getting out there and counting everything, and then making sure it got put on the truck. All right, down.
All right, thank you.
My past two summer internships were with Epic Management. I'm going to talk a little bit about them real quick. So Epic Management is based out of Piscataway, New Jersey. They're a program and construction management service. They deal as either a consultant or an agent or an at-risk construction manager. They also deal with hard bid negotiated general construction. They've performed over 1,000 projects in New York, New Jersey, and Connecticut in the since 1971. They also have two subdivisions beneath their company, Epic Interiors, which is just a general trade service that most of our jobs utilize that in some fashion, or Epic Millwork, and they usually do specialized carpentry, like custom cabinet work, so, and many of the smaller jobs they do usually use them as well. It's not very unique, but I guess unique to the company in the area. They have very good relationships with the SDA. What the SDA is, or the Schools Development Authority of New Jersey. So they have dealt with almost every major public school renovation in the state that's been kind of reaching out towards Pennsylvania as well. And they have very good relationship with Rutgers University. So a lot of the jobs that I was working with were dealing with local colleges and local universities. So my goals for this previous summer, the biggest one was communication, because I worked on a job my first summer, and the people I was working with were very relaxed in the terms they used, so a lot of swearing, a lot of just more down-to-earth people. This past summer I was in the office, And my first job involved me calling subcontractors and asking for proposals. And that's something I had never done and had no experience with. So I remember my first call was just me nervous on the phone because I wasn't sure what to ask for, who to ask for. And I wasn't sure if the company had any connections with this subcontractor, but I learned pretty quickly. So for the entire rest of the summer, I just wanted to learn how to handle the different types of people in the office. And I found out project managers were more like the people on the job site. They were very relaxed. They didn't mind. They talked differently as opposed to subcontractors that we didn't really know too well. I've also wanted to learn how to better understand construction documents because I didn't really deal with many on the previous job because it was nearing completion. So it was mainly just punch list items, things that were squared away before the substantial completion date. So this past summer I was able to deal with blueprints and site plans a lot more than I had in previous years. And I wanted to better understand how a final estimate was compiled. I understand that many companies will reach out to subcontractors to get price proposals for certain aspects of work, but I wasn't really sure what happened from point A to point B. I wasn't sure how they went about finding the prices and who was going to put everything together. Luckily, I got to work with the senior estimator a little bit later in my internship this past summer, so he was able to break that down a little bit better, easier way to understand. So at the end of the summer, I can confidently say I was able to achieve all these goals and then some. So this was my first internship experience. This was a 326,000 square foot building, three-story structure, $130 million. This was in Phillipsburg, New Jersey. This was their new high school that they had been planning for nearly a decade. And luckily, I joined this job at the end of it because this started development back in like 2004. Didn't actually start getting built until 2011. And somebody, I guess, in the county thought it would be a great idea to tear down the previous high school before the new one was even completed. So they had to deal with sending all the students to Worla studying trailers on the remains of the old high school. So there was a lot riding on this job to get done by the end of 2016. Major tasks for a typical day, this internship, I would be tracking down shipments. So it was a big high school, and it was almost like a vo-tech school where you'd be able to learn trades in like mechanics, plumbing. So they had a lot of laboratories set up. So you'd be getting things like drill presses or washing machines. I had to help coordinate where those would be going in the building and reaching out to the shipping companies because a lot of them ended up becoming arriving late. Coordinate concrete moisture tests. Before they could actually put down the flooring, there had to be moisture tests conducted. And one thing I realized, if you put a sign on a patch of concrete that you just sanded and put a little test down and say, do not touch. A lot of the subcontractors just touched it anyway and moved it because it got in the way of their work. So we had to conduct those tests three times. It took about 3 weeks. It's not fun to coordinate that. And landscape inspections were a big problem for the job site. As you can see, it's on a giant hill. So it would rain a lot and all of the dirt would go down the hill. And you can't really see too well, but behind the building, there's a bunch of roads, small county roads. They would just be completely covered by mud and soil, and the city was not happy about that. So we had to go make sure none of the drainage bags or none of the sides of the hills were eroding, because if that was the case, then we would actually have to start working more something serious into the mix, but luckily that didn't happen. So after this summer, my boss put me in the office previous summer. So I was in the estimating department, so I didn't have any specific job that I was like focusing on the entire time. But when I got there, there were 9 current projects they were planning on sending bids for. 3 of them were a new supermarket chain that was coming to the U.S. They were like rapidly expanding, and the remaining ones were for Rutgers University, whether they be really big projects, like they had a new sports complex for like a training facility, and the rest of them were real small renovations. Many of my tasks included reaching out to potential subcontractors, and that's where I was talking about. I had no experience with that, so I didn't know who to talk to or who to even call. I didn't really know. I used a blue book to reach out to people, and in the blue book it didn't specify whether they were union or non-union. And my project manager didn't tell me that what specific trades had to be union, which ones didn't have to be union.